Well, hello, hello, hello. How are you all? Happy Wednesday. I couldn't wait to record this video. I think I'm going to have to start doing like a Tuesday and Thursday tip or something because I miss you guys. I get so excited for all the feedback and the messages. It just warms my heart, blesses my soul that God gets the glory and that you see benefit and value to what I'm sharing as it relates to your life, because it's not about me, it's about you, and it's about service. And why do I want to serve you? Because God has called me to you. He's called me to women in business. Well, who am I? I'm Garlanda Price, and I'm the CEO of Glamour Cosmetics. I'm the CEO of Fusion Properties, and I'm an ordained pastor. And God has called me to women in business from ages 19 all the way to 100. Why? Because He's called me to serve and to be a servant leader. And entrepreneurship, I love it, love it, love it. I talk to about that, talk to you about free enterprise. I've owned businesses since I was 19 years old. I've made money, lost money, and through it all, God has blessed me to consistently earn a six-figure income. And like I said all the time in all my other videos, in case you haven't watched them, you have to watch them, but I always share that I already know that I'm heading to becoming a multimillionaire, and I know that you are all as well. And the reason why God has called me to share with you is because He wants me to help you to avoid the pitfalls. Everything I share with you is not going to always be about business tips, but it's going to be about business principles. It's going to be biblical principles. So it's always going to be something different, so you don't get bored, because you know we all have the attention span sometimes of a gnat. Was that a squirrel? I'm just kidding. But you all know how it is. It's like you'll be talking to someone or you'll be doing something and you're not focused. You're not in the moment. You're not there. And so what this is about is helping you gain ground, gain focus, get consistent at what God has called you to do, and to be and do all that God has called you to do. Because why? Because everything that you do in business, in ministry, in leadership, in marketplace ministry, in God's vineyard is going to impact positively the life of someone else. This is kingdom planting. This is kingdom seed planting, kingdom nurturing, kingdom watering, kingdom sunshine, and then kingdom harvesting. So it's all for the praise and glory and expansion of God's kingdom. So I come to you weekly, twice a week, just so you'll be encouraged and you'll know that what you're doing for God is not in vain, what you're doing for the kingdom of God is not in vain, and that it's necessary. So tonight on my drive home, I got off about an hour ago, and I was like, and I was getting ready to pray. I was like, God, well, you know, what do you want me to share? So the minute that I immediately thought, God, what do you want me to, the prodigal son popped in my head. I didn't even get the prayer completely out. So instead of asking God what He wanted me to share, I immediately just thank God for the word in advance of what to give you. So that's what we're going to start tonight. And then I was like, well, how does that even relate? But I've got it. We're going to tie it all in for you. So let's go there. So it's Luke 15, and we're going to do Luke 15:11 all the way over to Luke 15:22. So Jesus continued, there was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired men have food to spare, and here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father, and I say, and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. So he got up and he went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring him the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. I love that passage of scripture. So I wanted to look up and see what did prodigal mean? What did prodigal son mean? So it's someone that loses all of their money or time or resources in wild and riotous living, or just frivolously doesn't take care of their money, their resources, and their time. So many of you and many of us were prodigal sons in our lives, in our business, in our ministry, in leadership, in areas of our lives, right? But you can't get stuck there. And so what happens is you end up condemning yourself for past mistakes and past failures. You end up living below your standard of living, living below the means that God has given you, because his father was wealthy and now here he is, he's hired himself out. So some of you are in positions that are beneath you, dealing with people and things that are beneath you because you're not where you're supposed to be. You've hired yourself out for less than who you are. When you're a child of the king, you're royalty, you're heir to a throne, and you're living like a pauper. You're living like the hired help, right? And so for many of you, this scripture is so prevalent. For me, at a point in my life, it was, right? So here he was. There was a severe famine in the land. It didn't sound like his dad was having a famine, but we're going to talk about that. There was a severe famine in the whole land, and he longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating. He only wanted the scraps that the pigs had, right? So sometimes in our life, we settle for the scraps that the pigs have. We just want the little bit. We don't want the best that God has for us. We'll just settle for the scraps because in our minds, we become complacent in the things that we were supposed to do. And when we didn't do them, we began to have a pity party. Or we began to bellyache, it's too late, I should have done this yesterday. Or we have these monstrous things to do lists, and then every day we look at them and nothing gets done. Every week we look at them and nothing gets done. Every month we look at our goals and our visions and our plans and nothing gets done. Because you're holding yourself to, you were trying to hold yourself to an accountability standard that was above your measure of what you could do at that time, whatever the money, time, and resources that you had, right? So here it is, he's longing for the food that the pigs have. So sometimes God wants to give us, not sometimes, always God wants to give us his very best. But we consider our current situation or where we currently are, or our current condition, or our past condition where we got stuck, to be the best that we're going to get. But we serve a God that owns a cattle on 1,000 hills. What does that mean? Well, cattle and goats were wealth back in the day. They still represent wealth now. But if he owns cattle on 1,000 hills, he owns the cattle, he owns the land, he owns the meat processing plant, he owns the grocery stores, he owns everything. God owns everything to give provision for his people. So we don't have to eat scraps. We don't have to eat pods from pigs. We don't have to lay down with pigs. You don't have to stay in the current state that you're in, living like someone who squandered their resources or previously squandered them, and now it seems like you don't have enough. You're barely making ends meet. But you know, God has given you this vision and God has given you this business, right? Or he's given you this book to write, or this website to launch, or this film to produce. He's given you all these things, but now you feel like I've wasted too much time, talent, and money. Well, I come to tell you that you haven't, okay? So it's time for the prodigal son and daughter to return home. So when he came to his senses, everybody is going to have a Damascus Road experience. That's what I call it. When you're by yourself, because you can't hide from you. So whenever you get in a room by yourself, or you get in a car by yourself, but some of you stay so busy and stay too busy so you never have to deal with you. And what I encourage you to do is get somewhere and get quiet and come to yourself and allow you to come to yourself. I remember being at this low place in my life where I was between deciding if I was going to stay in God or if I was going to go back out into the world. And I literally was in a room. I had cut off the television. I had cut off the radio. I had cut off the lights. And I was crying, just sobbing and having a pity party. I felt like I was at my lowest place. I would have taken one of the pods that the pigs had to eat. I was just done. And I remember that the silence was deafening. Like, that may not even sound like it makes sense, but the silence was so loud I couldn't even hear. Nothing was on in the house or in the apartment at the time, and my silence was so loud I had to put my fingers to my ears. And I was pressing my fingers to my ears so hard, trying not to hear the noise of the silence. And I said, God, if I don't hear your voice audibly today, if I don't hear from you audibly today, like hear you speak, I'm going back out into the world and I'm not looking back. That's what I said to God, because that's how I felt at the time. Now, what does this have to do with the prodigal son? I was done. I was in sin. I just was not living the life that God had called me to live. I was condemning myself, and I just was over it. And so what happened was I was quiet as I could possibly be, and all this noise in my head, and I heard this small voice say, "Obey my commands." When I tell you, I screamed and cried out, "Obey my commands." That's all he said. But I got up, dusted myself off. I came to myself and I went back to my father, meaning I went back to the road to righteousness, the road to redemption. I got back to doing what God called me to do. And so it's never too late. All God has called us to do is obey his commands. And just like God, this father is a representation of how God views us. He saw him afar off. Right? So God can see us. We're never away from him. We're never so lost and so deep in the pit that he can't find us. He said, "There's no pit deeper than I'm not deeper still." So he said, "There's no height, no depth, no principality, no thing above, no thing beneath that can separate us from his love." So you've got to get back up, get on your horse, come to yourself, have an honest conversation with yourself about the fact that you have not done what God called you to do. You have not mastered your time, resources, and talents. It's okay. And I'm going to give you a scripture that tells you it's okay. It's okay. Cry it out, walk it out, limp it out. Do whatever you got to do to get back to your father. And then he repented. He said, "Father, I've sinned against heaven and you." So some of you, just like I had to do, and just like everyone else had to do, we have to come to God right. So we've got to repent. We've got to ask for forgiveness for wasting our time, wasting his talents, wasting the resources, wasting the money. Because he's given all of us the talents, meaning the money that we needed to do what we needed to do. And even if we squandered it, so what? He has more. He doesn't run out of money. He doesn't run out of people to give you the money. He doesn't run out of anything that you need. And he's standing right here ready to provide it for you, because it says that. It says, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him." So when you come to your senses, you repent, you turn back and ask God for forgiveness, he will immediately place you in the best robe that he has. The next thing that he did was he said, "Place a ring on his finger," because a ring represents royalty. So now he's set to, again, to crown you in leadership on your finger as a king or a queen. He's already set to promote you and put you back in position. And then he said, "Put sandals on his feet," because I don't believe that everybody back in those days had shoes. I don't know. But I know that if you had money, you had shoes, right? And they were probably leather sandals. So now he's girded up your feet so that you're not just walking around in the dirt, that you have on shoes, a robe, and a ring, which is a position of authority, right? And then he said, "Bring the fattened calf and kill it." So now he wants to serve you with his best, and he plans to give you his best. So he's already saying it right here. "I'm getting ready to set you up." He said, "Let's have a feast and celebrate, because you were dead. Your vision was dead. Your idea was dead. The things he had planted in you looked dead. They looked dormant. But now he said, "Bring him forth, because my son was dead and now he's alive. He was lost and now he's found." So they began to celebrate. So tonight, God wants to celebrate you. He wants you to come back, turn back to that thing that he called you to do. Hear him in your own ear. Obey my command and go and do what thus saith the Lord for his kingdom, in your business and in your ministry and in leadership and all that he's called you to do. And just one scripture I want to leave you with, and I'm sorry that we went over, I got carried away, was Romans 8:1. "Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." That means that he washes it all into the sea of forgetfulness. The only people that remember is us. And the only one that wants to remind you is the enemy. But you will use the word of God against the enemy and he will flee. So you tell him, "Satan, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death." So go live, go be set free, turn around, come to yourself, go back and be crowned in glory, and do what thus saith the Lord. I look forward to all y'all's businesses and everything, your books, your manuscripts, everything that God has called you to do. I'm super excited and I love you. Bye.